Hello, Mr. Taru. Okay, we got one last video to use before, before I finally erase this unit circle and start moving on to another topic, and our six basic trig functions that we have. Let's take a look at the cosine of 2.3 times the secant of 2.3, and see if we can't evaluate that expression without the use of a calculator. Now, most questions in pre-calc or trig that ask you to not use a calculator involve angles that are around this unit circle. And certainly, I do not see an angle measure of 2.3 radians. These radians are all an exact value, pi over 6, pi over 4, and so on. So how are we supposed to analyze this expression without the use of a calculator? Well, we need to remember the reciprocal identities that I had in just the past video. There's a link above my head if you want to click back to it. Or if there's not, there will be soon. So the cosine of 2.3, secant of 2.3. Cosine and secant, as you can see with these little identities, are reciprocals of each other. Cosine is x over r, secant's r over x. So cosine, this becomes a cosine of 2.3 times 1 over the cosine of 2.3. This is one of the identities that we have in our pre-calc or trig book that says the secant of an angle measure is equal to 1 divided by the cosine of that same angle, because indeed they are reciprocals of each other. And then of course, anything divided by itself, the cosine of 2.3 divided by the cosine of 2.3, is simply going to come out to a value of 1. So, even though we have an angle that's not on the unit circle, we can still evaluate that angle. Keeping the same angle of 2.3, if I said the sine squared of 2.3 plus the cosine squared of 2.3, what is that equal to? Well, this is one of the Pythagorean identities. We've got sine squared plus cosine squared. Well, we don't have it written here, but our first Pythagorean identity says that that's equal to 1. And indeed, it is. I showed a proof for this identity in a previous lesson. I'll do this really quick anyway. Why not? Do it again. Why does this equal 1? Well, sine of an angle measure, with a trig function, you put in an angle measure and you get out the sides of a triangle. So the sine of 2.3 squared, actually, you know what? I'm not going to do a proof because then somebody's going to say, well, you know, where did the x and y's come from and where did the 2.3's go? Just watch the previous video of evaluating and proving the trig identities that I just put. There'll be a link above my head as well. This is a Pythagorean identity and does always come out to be 1. Let's do something that is on the unit circle, such as the secant squared of pi over 4 minus tangent squared of pi over 4. Well, if you know the three Pythagorean identities, you already know what this answer is, and again, previous video. But let's just evaluate this with the pi over 4 radians that's given to us on the from the unit circle. So the secant squared of pi over 4. Well, pi over 4 is 45 degrees, and secant is reciprocal of, let's see, secant's r over x, so secant's a reciprocal of cosine. So at pi over 4, the cosine value is square root of 2 over 2, and the secant is a reciprocal of cosine, so that's going to be 2 over the square root of 2 minus the tangent of pi over 4. Now notice what I'm doing here with the exponent of 2. Kind of looks like you're squaring the math function, but you're actually squaring the result of the secant of pi over 4. The tangent of pi over 4, tangent is y over x, and anytime you take a y and x value that are equal, or you divide two numbers that are the same, you do always get an answer of 1. So the tangent of pi over 4 is equal to 1. This comes out to be 2 squared is 4, and the square root of 2 squared is equal to 2 minus 1. We need a common denominator for that. So our common denominator is going to be, we'll multiply top and bottom by 2. So we have 4 minus 2, which is 2 over 2. and that comes out to be equal to 1. Now, that might ring a bell because if I take this equation and I kind of just erase this for a second, and I write one of the Pythagorean identities that involves tangent, it is 1 or secant squared theta equals 1 plus tangent squared theta. You might find that, I hope you find that, Pythagorean identity in your pre-calc or trig book. Well, this is an identity. This is one of the three Pythagorean identities. And if I take the tangent function, tangent squared function, and subtract it from both sides, I get the secant squared theta minus tangent squared theta equals 1. So, while I showed you what this equal to by using angles off the unit circle, we could also have known immediately that it was equal to 1 because we know the Pythagorean identity, and there are three of them. So make sure you pay attention to those and you memorize them. It will make your work a lot more efficient. Okay, now I've done a whole bunch of questions off the unit circle lately and talking about how we set it up. Now I want to do some trig functions without the use of this unit circle. Oh, I hate erasing that. Okay. So let's set up. We're not really going to evaluate trig functions, but we're going to set some trig functions up. So, and find the other trig ratios. So we have the sine of theta equals 8 over 17. Now sine is y over r, and there's two quadrants where the y value is positive, quadrant 1 and quadrant 2. So we need more direction if we're going to set up. The purpose of this question is we're going to set up the other trig functions based off of the sine function. Well, I'm going to say that theta is between 0 and 90, or I could say 0 and pi over 2. But whatever it is, whether it's degrees or radians, I want my angle measure to be in quadrant 1. Now, the directions here are the sine of theta is 8 over 17. Use that trig function and the fact that we know that we want the angle to be in quadrant 1 to set up the other six trig functions. Well, my textbook at this point is asking students to use the three Pythagorean identities to work these out, but I really like to stress the idea that all we're studying is right triangles and their rotations and standard position around the origin, and thus being the rotation inside of a circle. So instead of using just one of the Pythagorean identities, I want to make a drawing. I want to set this up as a drawing in quadrant 1. So I'm going to draw just any old, I don't really know what theta is, so I'm just going to draw a generic angle in quadrant 1. I'm going to set up a reference triangle, and I'm going to remember that the side of an angle, when you put an angle measure into a trig function, you get out the sides of a triangle. So when it says sine of theta is 8 over 17, that's my y value, and the 17 is going to be my r value. So I have 8 and 17. Now the Pythagorean theorem, which I'll need to do to finish this up if I don't remember this special triangle, is going to be x squared plus 8 squared equals 17 squared. That's going to be x squared plus 64. Josh, what's 17 squared?
289.
Thank you, sir. 289. Now I'm going to subtract both sides by 64. He said he was going to be quiet in the video, but he didn't know I was going to recruit him. So we get x squared equals 225, and then I'm going to square root both sides and find out that x is equal to 15. I knew the final answer, but I forgot what 17 squared was, so thank you. So we got y over r from the original trig function, and now our x value is 15. Well, if you remember that the study of trigonometry is just, well, not completely, but for the vast majority of it, the study of right triangles and the rotations around a circle. Well, if I have all three sides of my reference triangle set up, I can do any trig function I want. I can come up with any trig function I want. So, and the fact that I have this drawn and it's in quadrant 1 will make sure that I have all my sines correct. So, you want the cosine of theta? Well, it's just x over r. If you would like the cotangent of theta, well, that's just x over r. If you would like the secant of theta, well, secant is reciprocal of cosine, so that's just going to be, instead of x over r over x, or 17 over 15, and so on. I can set up the other two trig functions, but I hope you get the idea by now. All right, let's do one more, or as many as I have before my 15-minute alarm starts going off. Okay, let's take a look at this problem. The sine of theta is equal to 3/5, and the cosine of theta is equal to negative 4/5. Now, for this question, I still want to help you set up the other trig functions. We're never going to find out what theta is at this point. We can with a calculator, but I just want to set up the trig functions, the trig ratios. But I'm not telling you what quadrant you're in. Well, don't forget, you put an angle measure into a trig function and you get out the sides of a triangle. So this is y over r. Now, if these fractions have been reduced, I guess it might be possible to not have exactly the same denominator, but it will need to be the same once both fractions get reduced. Cosine, when you put in an angle measure, is x over r. And looking at these two trig functions together and realizing that sine is mainly based on y, r is always positive. The cosine is x over r, and x is always positive, or excuse me, the r is. Well, here we have a negative x, and with the sine we have a positive y. What quadrant has a negative x and a positive y? Again, r is always positive, so when you see a negative trig function, it's based off the negative or positiveness of x or y. So, negative x, positive y, that's in quadrant 2. So, let's get a drawing in quadrant 2, angle in standard position. Do I care what the angle looks like? Not really, just as long as it's in quadrant 2. That's theta. Always the rotation off the standard position rotation is off of the positive side of the x-axis. Again, with our reference triangle, reference triangles are always drawn against the x-axis. Reference angles are always less than 90. And sine is y over r, so we have 3/5. And we're not going to need the Pythagorean identity or the Pythagorean theorem for this problem, because given sine and cosine, I'm already given all three sides of the triangle. And once I have the three sides of my reference triangle set up, I can find the ratio of any trig function I like. Now notice with the negative 4, I put this as a negative x value, not because you can have a negative length, but it denotes a movement to the left on the next on the x-axis. So let's just set up one of these. The tangent of theta, remembering that tangent is y over x, is 3/4, negative 3/4. And indeed, I can set up any trig function I'd like. Let's just do one more. The cosecant of theta is 5/3. That's my last example. That's a couple of quick examples of how to evaluate trig functions based off the unit circle, which I've now erased. Some trig functions, both my first and second example, can be solved by understanding your quotient identities and your reciprocal identities, and most importantly, the ones you use a lot, or your three Pythagorean identities. And then we set up a couple of trig ratios, and converted from one trig function to another without ever actually knowing what theta is. I'm Mr. True. I'm out. If you got any questions, please leave me a comment. Bam! Thank you very much.